This is the 18th Airborne Corps Podcast, the official podcast of the United States military, coming to you from the center of the military universe, Fort Bragg, North Carolina, with your host, Joe Bacino.
Hey folks, Joe Bacino here. It's the 18th Airborne Corps Podcast. From December 16, 1944 to January 25, 1945, the Battle of the Bulge roared in the Ardennes region of Belgium. This is the third of a five-part series on the Battle of the Bulge. We're releasing this series in concert with the 77th anniversary of that Ardennes counteroffensive. The Battle of the Bulge, of course, was a major German offensive campaign on the Western Front during World War II. Officially, the Ardennes counteroffensive, the fight earned the lasting nickname Battle of the Bulge. The German initial thrust protruded on an operational map like a bulging front. The Battle of the Bulge was a critical event towards the end of World War II. The German forces ahead of this seemed defeated. The end of the war seemed just about over. And then German tank forces launched a stunning, massive counterattack in an under-defended sector. That's the start of the Battle of the Bulge. Now, traditionally, when we think about this fight, we think about the big personalities. Tony McAuliffe from the 101st Airborne with the nuts response. I briefly told that story in episode 94. It's a great story, but not really that impactful to the war or to the situation in the Ardennes. Of course, you have Creighton Abrams rolling the 37th Tank Battalion into Bastogne. You have the Brit, Bernard Law Montgomery, at one point the commander of all ground forces in the northern part of the Bulge. J. Lawton Collins' 7th Corps, also in the north. Of course, anything with Patton dominates just about every discussion about World War II, and that's unfortunately true for the Battle of the Bulge. But today I'm talking about none of those people. I want to talk about Matthew B. Ridgway, the commander of the 18th Airborne Corps during the Battle of the Bulge. Ridgway rarely gets proper credit for his role here. His perspective is a story that's not often told when we talk about this fight. In fact, it's barely a footnote in this man's legacy. I looked up the New York Times obituary of Matthew Ridgway, July 27, 1993, just to prove a point. The headline reads, Matthew B. Ridgway dies at 98, leader of U.S. troops in two wars. It's a 3,414-word piece. The Battle of the Bulge is not mentioned. Ardennes is not mentioned. Now, this guy did a lot of things, okay? Korean War, Chief of Staff of the Army, early part of the Cold War, World War II, formation of airborne forces. So he did a lot of things, but this moment deserved a mention in his obituary. His leadership is important to the successful resolution of the fight here. And it's a critical moment for him, it's a critical moment for the Allied forces, it's a critical moment for the 18th Airborne Corps. So let's set the table. Matthew Ridgway was, of course, the great commander of the 82nd Airborne Division during the early part of World War II. He led his men into Normandy. After that, he was given command of this corps, this new airborne corps, and he directed the jump into the Netherlands during Operation Market Garden. Obviously, he jumped with his men. By December 1944, the 18th Airborne was Eisenhower's reserve force. The unit was resting and refitting with units spread out in France and England. They'd been out of the fight for weeks after Market Garden. The headquarters and Ridgway himself was in England. And at the time, the Corps only had two units, the 82nd Airborne and the 101st Airborne. December 16th, as we said, the shocking German counteroffensive begins. The fighting goes on all day on the 16th, all day on the 17th. Ridgway knows nothing about it. His command knows nothing about it. Then, on the night of December 17th, Ridgway is alerted by Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force, which is in France. And I should explain, and I just want to make reference to this. I don't want to get bogged down in rabbit holes like I know you accuse me of doing. But Ridgway was not with his men at the time of the alert. He was in England training the new 17th Airborne Division, a new airborne unit. He's actually training the 17th to potentially jump into Germany with the 18th Airborne Corps to end the war. So, Ridgway gets the word. This is happening. Stunning counterattack. Shit's going down. He alerts his troops. In less than 34 hours, he pushes his troops out of barracks, out of bivouacs, and into the line. Now, this 34 hours is more impressive than it sounds. Today, troops can get anywhere in the world really quickly. Commanders can push soldiers out, get soldiers places. You can text people. You can get people back on alert. But the 18th Airborne didn't really have any organic transportation. This was, after all, a unit equipped to fly or parachute into battle. So he had to coordinate for transportation. He got all his men on 10-ton open trucks and trailers and got them going. And the 82nd led the road march in. So these are not troops that are prepared or accustomed to a long road march, but he organized it, pushed them out. Ridgway then flew to France to meet with the Allied leadership in person. And as I reviewed the official records from Chaffe, the Supreme Allied Headquarters, and the archived documents, it looks like he was only at the headquarters for less than 2 hours, then immediately flew back and got on the road to meet with his men in Belgium. So went to the headquarters, got briefed up, here's what your mission is, and then flew back and then got into his Jeep and then got on the road. So most of the 18th Airborne arrives in Spa, Belgium, the morning of December 18th. Ridgway gets there by early evening. Okay, once in sector, Ridgway sends the 101st to defend Bastogne under the 8th Corps. So the Screaming Eagles, the 101st, are gone. They're under another corps. Ridgway retains the 82nd Airborne, commanded by General Jim Gavin, to bolster the defense of the North Shoulder, the northern part of this German bulge. So the 18th Airborne Corps has to defend against the northern push of this enemy penetration, and he's fighting under control of the 1st Army. Now, the first problem Ridgway has to deal with is a fellow named Alan Jones. Jones is a 2-star general in command of the 106th Infantry Division. The 106th has been completely crushed, run over. Ridgway absorbs the 106th into the 18th Airborne. Now, this division was at full strength just days before, but this was a unit brand new to combat, a green unit. The Ardennes, you see, was a peaceful, sleepy sector, not much doing. Not much risk of a German strike there. A good place for an untested unit. Until, of course, the morning of December 16th. The 106th was not ready for December 16th. More than half of the division was captured by German forces. And there's something else weighing on Alan's mind. Alan Jones, the commander of the 106th. His son, an officer in the 106th, is missing. He's likely killed in that initial German thrust. So when Ridgway arrives, Jones has checked the fuck out. In his mind, he's gone. His staff doesn't know where he is. I found one report that reads that he's in a tavern playing the organ, while his men are just shell-shocked. So Ridgway, rather than relieve him, brings him up into the corps and makes him the deputy corps commander. He wants to keep an eye on this guy, make sure he doesn't kill himself, save him any further embarrassment. Now, really quickly here, Ridgway starts absorbing more and more forces. So 1st Army just starts pushing divisions. Remember, Ridgway started with his traditional units, the 82nd, the 101st, two airborne units. Then he loses the 101st. Now he's down only to the 82nd Airborne. Well, pretty soon he's assigned a bunch of other units, non-airborne units. Three armor divisions and three traditional infantry divisions. By December 21st, so just a few days into this, Ridgway has a massive corps, 97,000 soldiers and 10 divisions. That is a World War II field army. He went from having one division to 10 in a few days. And it's forces he's not all that familiar with. Ridgway's an airborne guy, had been since the war started. Now he's commanding armored divisions. So by the morning of December 21st, by the way, Ridgway knows he's got to reinforce St. Vith. This is in the key position restricting the German advance. Don't worry too much about the geography here. Bottom line is the Germans are pushing west. And in that bulge, you think about a bulge on a map there, Ridgway's in the north. If the German panzer forces can't get through St. Vith, which is in Ridgway's sector, they're not going to advance. The bulge will eventually collapse. Got to protect St. Vith. So Ridgway puts the 7th Armored Division on the line there. 7th Armored Division is another one, another division, like the 106 that got all fucked up in the early mornings of the German counteroffensive. They were there initially, and Ridgway puts them back out on line. The division's battered, and he sends them back. You're going back out. Now, I read firsthand accounts of the 7th Armored Division soldiers and officers who were very critical of Ridgway, accused him of just being uncaring, callous, unfeeling. The commander of that 7th Armored Division, General Robert Hasbrook, asked to pull his men off the line, pulled them out of the fight. Ridgway said no, refused. You're staying out there. Eventually, they had to be withdrawn. They plugged the line until they were rendered combat ineffective, beaten to a pulp. Ridgway wore them down to a nub. But he had to protect St. Vith, and he was going to use any asset he had available to do so. Commanders have to make tough decisions in war. You have to have ice running through your veins in these situations. That's among the many, many reasons I wouldn't be a very good combat leader. Got to be able to make tough decisions and not be affected by them. This was one of those decisions. These were hard men. This was a hard time. Ridgway had to make a hard call. I read some accounts, some statements by 7th Armored Division folks who honestly believed that Ridgway kept them in the line to humiliate them because they did so poorly against the initial German punch. Not true. Ridgway did have compassion for the American soldier. He did understand the situation they were in. He did understand and appreciate all the odds stacked against the men of the 7th Armored Division. He cared for the welfare of the troops, but he landed on the decision he landed on. Now, as the fight continues beyond December 22nd into January, Ridgway uses the sufficient force structure that he has wisely. He rotates divisions into reserve to prevent exhaustion, to prevent his units from culminating. He actually kept his troops fresh for the follow-on counterattacks in January. For example, around mid-January, it appears based on the original situation maps to be January 13th, but I'm not 100% on that. Around that time, certainly, Ridgway replaced the tired but battle-tested 82nd Airborne Division with the fresh but completely untested 75th Infantry Division for a counterattack east. And it works. The 75th fights hard, moves quickly, pushes through at night. So Ridgway demonstrates that he understood the capabilities of the men under his care. He understood how much they could be pushed. That's combat leadership. In the Battle of the Bulge, Ridgway also demonstrates that he understands operational tempo. He understands momentum. He understands how to exploit favorable conditions. His 18th Airborne Corps, alongside the 7th Corps, is, as we said, in the north. Patton's 3rd Army's in the south. These are forces that are going to come together to pinch off that bulge. Ridgway knows when to push his forces forward, when to hold back, when to push out small groups with direct fire, when to push a division en masse south. Deep into January, as the German defenses are melting away, Ridgway made sure his subordinate commanders understood that our forces, our boys, are still outgunned by the German tanks. He made sure his subordinate commanders knew they're still outgunned. You're still in a fight. He gave very explicit orders. No force-on-force fights in open terrain. Use terrain and fog to mass movement. Employ tank destroyers. This is still not a level playing field, so artillery will have to be the equalizer. Ridgway saw the Battle of the Bulge to its successful conclusion. With unfamiliar armored formations under his command, he repulsed every attack. He put his troops in position to counterattack. He erased the bulge. By the time the Battle of the Bulge ended on January 25, 1945, Dwight Eisenhower felt that Ridgway matured as a general officer over the course of the campaign, and certainly over the course of the war. In a performance appraisal on February 1, 1945, Eisenhower described Ridgway as a magnetic, courageous, and balanced fighter. So that's Ridgway. That's his leadership. That's the kind of leadership we're expecting from our generals today, from our combat leaders today, and that's what we're looking for when we understand great leadership in World War II. I'll leave it there. A story we don't hear very often. I do want to provide some reference material I used to study Ridgway in the Battle of the Bulge. And during the war, Matthew often wrote contemporaneous memorandums, to capture conversations with peers, superiors, and subordinates. They're actually pretty detailed, and he wrote a lot of them. Those memorandums, all of them, and his war diary are available at the U.S. Army Heritage and Education Center in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. I used those to put this together. I also referenced a number of great books. The three primary books I made reference to are Harold Winton's Corps Commanders of the Bulge, Gregory Fontenot's Loss and Redemption at St. Vith, and then the other big one that I think everybody references with regard to Battle of the Bulge is Charles B. McDonald's A Time for Trumpets. My friend Dr. Conrad Crane wrote a great article in the fall 2019 edition of Parameters, which is the Army War College quarterly publication. The article is titled Matthew Ridgway and the Battle of the Bulge, and it offers a lot of insight. Finally, there's a really good history published by the Army Center for Military History in 1993. It's titled The Ardennes Battle of the Bulge. So that's it. Matthew Ridgway, an example of leadership in combat, and a story we should all know more about. Tomorrow, episode 97, We Are All Jews Here. This is my favorite story of this campaign, and certainly one of the most compelling stories from World War II that I've ever heard. Thanks so much for listening. It's just a GI Jive, man.